Good morning, everybody. Welcome to all of you coming so early, and welcome to the panel discussion, Rebuilding for Good, how physical therapy projects can bring long-term sustainable benefits in conflict zones and in areas of disaster. So the organizers have been able to put together a fantastic team with two people working permanently in disaster areas. That's David Charles and Najmuddin Helal, completely at the left side for you. And three people working for humanitarian organizations supporting local structures in disaster areas, in areas of conflict. My name is Theo Verhoeff. I'm based in Switzerland. I'm a Dutch-trained physiotherapist. I have a master's degree in public health. I've been working 15 years in low-income countries and in conflict areas with the Dutch Ministry of Development Cooperation and with the International Committee of the Red Cross. And the last 15 years I've been doing the same, but based in Geneva, where I presently had a special fund for the disabled, which was created by the International Committee of the Red Cross. So before my colleagues will introduce themselves, just a few words on why this topic. We all noticed the increase in natural disasters the last years. Haiti, of course, is a most recent example. India. In Iran, Pakistan, Indonesia, as well as the fact that many conflicts, they have become chronic also. Even countries which emerge from conflict, nearly half of them return into conflict within 5 years. So these two types of disasters, the natural disasters and the man-made disasters, they often have the combined effect of increasing the needs for physical rehabilitation and physiotherapy, and at the same time reducing the facilities which exist, the few facilities which exist already. Secondly, there has been more attention for people with disabilities as a group in general. The just out last week, the World Report on Disability by WHO and the World Bank, they give a lot of information, a lot of useful information. Another important event for the higher attention is the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which was ratified after an extremely short period in 2008. And there is the position statement of the WCPT on disaster management, which you can find on the web. And you will find also a lot of relevant information, reference materials, on this topic on the website of the WCPT. So we will read it together, I propose. The World Confederation for Physical Therapy recognizes that natural, technological, and pandemic disasters have a major and long-lasting impact on people and the countries in which they live. Physical therapists, as experts in physical rehabilitation, should be involved in disaster preparedness, policy, and planning, in preventive education, and in active rehabilitation of victims of disasters to ensure that populations affected have access to rehabilitation services to achieve the highest attainable level of health. So, there is more attention on addressing the needs of persons with disabilities. And the objectives of these sessions are to explore the nature of physiotherapy at times of conflict, together with you, what are the reality of the working conditions in these type of settings, and of course also to discuss how to develop long-term sustainable services, how to marry the short-term objectives of an emergency phase with the long-term objectives of national capacity building, what are the required competencies to provide appropriate assistance, etc. So how are we going to proceed from here? Each panel member, my five colleagues, they will give a short presentation of themselves and maybe one or two points which they find relevant for the discussion and from personal experiences. Afterwards, the floor is yours. I'm sure there are many people in the audience with your own experience, with your own experience in these kind of settings, and we would like to exchange information. We welcome your comments, your suggestions on the topic. The procedure is there are microphones, so please go to one of the microphones, state your name and your country, pose your question, preferably concisely, so that many people will have a chance to pose questions or comments or suggestions. And different views on certain topics, they may of course exist, they will of course exist. Many people have gone through strong experiences also doing this kind of work. Different views, they are welcome, but I kindly ask everybody also to respect people with other viewpoints. So, and with this, I would like to ask the first person, Chiara, to present yourself.
Good morning. My name is Chiara Retis. I'm a physical therapist and I work as a technical advisor for Handicap International. Handicap International is an international humanitarian organization. It's a federation that works for people to improve the life of people living in disabling conditions in different contexts. So that might be poverty, conflict, or disaster. In emergency contexts, but also in development situations. I worked as a clinical physical therapist in Italy, and then in the field, in projects, in the Middle East, in Afghanistan, especially. I'd like to remind that Handicap International intervenes in situation of disasters, and examples might be the last one, Haiti, but also Pakistan, China with the earthquakes, and after the tsunami, especially in Indonesia and Sri Lanka. The two points that I'd like to raise and share with you on the thematic, on the subject of today, is about the role of the physical therapists in emergency situation. So there are the both sides that are interesting. One is the common competencies, so to provide physical therapy care and prevention of complications since the beginning. So the work in hospital setting, for example, where our specialties are important, but also to have a community-oriented approach is something that has an added value that is very, really necessary in a disaster context in order to go towards the people and their community, especially caregivers and the family, since infrastructures, connections, referral to hospital or health services are often destroyed by the missing, by the circumstances. The other point is about the place that physical therapists might take in a very broad, multi-actors environment, both in the very acute moment after the disaster, so international organizations that are providing food, shelter, and water, and later on with the variety of actors that are in place, including the local professionals, if they exist, and other international organizations that are helping. So the importance to really be in the chain of the actors involved in the action.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Shaun Cleaver, and I'm a physiotherapist originally from Canada. Currently headed back to Canada from international commitments, and I'll start a doctorate at the University of Toronto in September. Now, what I will present to you today is a stance, a position, a thesis. And that is that the best way that our profession can address disasters is to look beyond the disaster. And the reason is that disasters capture attention. This attention can be good. The needs are really there, and our profession, as should the global community, respond to disasters, but I don't believe that we should focus on disasters. We must look further. And that is because although disasters create opportunity for progress in the areas in which we work and we address, they're not the only, nor are they necessarily the best time to make this progress. Now let me explain how I've come to this conclusion. My experience in disaster work is in response to the Haitian earthquake of January 2010, after which I worked in Haiti for a year. But prior to that, I'd spent 2 years in Haiti. And those 2 years were filled with limitations on what we could accomplish in physical therapy and rehabilitation because of lack of resources, because of lack of recognition of what we do and what we're able to offer people, and a lack of interest in the overall, from the global community, as to the recognition of the needs that existed in Haiti. The earthquake changes substantially. After the earthquake, we saw nearly the opposite situation, where there was nearly a convulsive response from the international community, where all eyes were focused on the activities happening in Haiti. This did create some changes which are beneficial for the country. Prior to the earthquake, there were at most 2 to 3 permanent jobs for physical therapists in Haiti. Now in 2011, that's different. There's more care in 2011. But there were needs long before that were unrecognized. And I'm worried that in another 5 or 10 years that those needs will again be unrecognized. So the real challenge for our profession, surrounded to disasters, is to build strong systems everywhere. And they had the system of physical therapy and rehabilitation in Haiti been stronger before the earthquake, that would have had a much stronger impact on what could have happened as part of the earthquake response. To represent this most specifically, because of the earthquake, it was estimated that between 1 in 200 Haitians suffered spinal cord injuries, looking at one clinical pathology among many granted. From my experience working in Haiti outside of the earthquake setting, I would estimate that there are 300 per year who suffer from spinal cord injuries. Next slide again. And as proof, this is a communication from a time when David were working at, and I were working at Hôpital Albert Schweitzer 6 months prior to the earthquake, where we had a patient with a spinal cord injury, and I think you can see some of the text there, that the options for what we could do were very limited. If it were so that I was a Haitian who suffered a spinal cord injury, I would far rather that it occurred on January 12th, 2010, than I would in August 2009. Because at that time, our system wasn't even in the mindset that this was a pathology that could be treated. But as part of the tremendous international response because of the earthquake, we did see people who had opportunities that were otherwise unimaginable to be airlifted to other countries for immediate emergency treatment. And I agree that those interventions were beneficial, but they're also very high cost, very limited, and unsustainable, and likely not going to be available on the long-term basis in Haiti for many other people who suffer spinal cord injuries with time. Yeah. Now, there was, as I mentioned, a change after the earthquake that saw more opportunities. But nonetheless, we see this email from within our organization in July, approximately 6 months after the earthquake, which clearly shows what our status quo was at the institution, and that at that time it looked like we were going to return to it, which is a spinal cord injury presenting to our hospital is sent home nearly immediately. We in Haiti can do better, and across the world we can do better. I think that we should harness the international interest and attention that disasters engender to the work that we do. But we need to look beyond that to make changes that will make impacts for people.
Thank you, Shaun.
Good
Good morning. My name is Nancy Kelly, and I must confess I'm not a physical therapist. thank you. And I'm the executive director of an organization called Health Volunteers Overseas. We're coming up on our 25th anniversary. Our focus as an organization is on capacity building, on training and education of healthcare providers in developing countries. As such, we do not typically have a presence in disaster situations. We tend to come in once the chronic phase is over, and the more long-term chronic problem, with the problem that will continue for years and years, is the time that HVO tends to come in and have a presence. That said, I have worked with close to 900 PTs in the last 25 years, and I have enormous respect for PTs and for the capacities that PTs bring to the development work that we do, and I think this is applicable to disaster situations too, because I think your clinical perspective and your training gives you a lot of the skills and aptitudes that are really needed in a disaster situation. I'm thinking of teamwork, collaborating with other members of the clinical team, your patient focus, empathy, working with the patient, finding out what it is that they need or how they're thinking and trying to move them along. Planning, PTs are great in developing short-term and long-term plans and goals, and again, in implementing those plans, working with the patient and with your colleagues to get the patient from here to there. And being an advocate for the patient, being an advocate for people with disabilities, for vulnerable populations. I think all of those are attributes that are extremely important in a disaster situation. But what I would say is for people who are thinking that they would like to get involved in a disaster situation and make a contribution, I would say that if you're not coming at it with specific experience, you should stop and ask yourself a few questions. Why is it you want to do this? What is it that you're going to bring of value to the situation? And granted, I have outlined some things that I think you do bring, but you do have to be honest about, do you know the language? Are you able to live in extremely difficult conditions? Are you going to be someone that is going to need to be helped? Are you going to be taking someone's time and energy away from something else so that they can provide you with the support so that you can make a contribution? It's a very difficult situation. For example, in Haiti, the living situation after the earthquake. So you really have to be someone who has not only the professional attributes but the experience and language skills and a whole range of other skills that will mean that when you come to a site, you're actually of value to the site and not a drain on the site. And that's what I have to say.
Thank you. Najmuddin.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Najmuddin Helal, a physiotherapist from Afghanistan. I have been worked for the rehabilitation program of International Committee of the Red Cross, the ICRC, for over 23 years. And as you know all, Afghanistan has been at war for more than 30 years now. Based on my work experience and personal life, I can say that physiotherapy service can be set up and become permanent service even in conflict and active war situation. My points that I would like to mention, physiotherapy must be considered an essential service, even in emergency situation. Physiotherapy is a priority always. It is not something to be postponed for better times, times of peace. Example, myself, I am a disabled person. I lost both my legs due to a landmine. I got physiotherapy and an artificial leg during war, more than 25 years ago. Can you imagine what my life and the life of the Afghans like me would be if I had to wait for peace to get physiotherapy and artificial legs? In the hospital for war injured, it is proved that physiotherapy contributes to improve the condition of the patients, prevent complication, and reduce bed occupancy. It is definitively useful. During the war, second point, during the war, physical rehabilitation has to be available and provided to any kind of patients, war victims and non-war victims. No discrimination can be made. The third, the standard of the rehabilitation service must be kept as high as possible, mainly through constant teaching and training. For this purpose, cooperation with existing school has to be kept strong and active always. You know, there is an extremely important point to be considered. The conflict in emergency time or difficult moment, yes. But they also offer unique opportunity for establishing the basis for permanent and sustainable rehabilitation service. Times of war are extremely extraordinary moment where things become possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Najmuddin. Then David.
Good morning. My name is David Charles, physical therapist from Haiti, trained at the Pontificia Universidad Católica Madre y Maestra in Dominican Republic. I am the current rehabilitation services manager of Hospital Abbé in Deschapelles, Haiti. As I work in the countryside, I've been working in developing the community-based rehabilitation in the Artibonite Valley. I had my biggest experience working in disaster emergency situation from the earthquake happened in Haiti on January 12, 2010. So today we will approach with you the challenges of working as physical therapists in working during the emergency disaster situations. Since I had my biggest experience then, since our work with this specific population keep being a big challenges for the Asian physical therapists.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, David. Okay, after this introduction, I would like to open the floor if there are any questions from your side, any comments on some of the points which were raised by members of our panel. Well, you think I might ask somebody a question. I'd like to ask two people a question, one from the ones working permanently in disasters and one from the humanitarian organizations. If you could state what has been the biggest barrier in carrying out your work. Maybe one of the three of you first.
The biggest barrier in the acute situation, emergency, I can give you the example of Indonesia after the tsunami. The majority, there were people died, there were people injured, but in fact, the most tracking the big barrier was the destruction of the infrastructures and environment. So, if we think of the target groups, we are not only helping people injured or people with disability that are facing challenging situation because they lose their assistive devices, because they lose their network, their usual environment, but also people that are more vulnerable in that situations, for example, the eldest people. So this has to be taken into account since the very beginning if we really want to have an impact on the population that has been that is suffering the situation. So we might be able to provide a direct, very high quality support, like medical, kind of medical support. But what really makes the difference, and we can make the difference as physical therapists, is really to open our perspective and be able to see the needs, the broader needs of the whole population in a context where the environment is disabling. So not only the injuries by themselves, but also the disabling environment. This has an impact also in the long term. So in fact, the disaster that is happening quickly, in a few moments, in a few days, will have an impact in the long term on people, on the environment, and so in the whole community. So this is one of the biggest challenges for all the humanitarian actors, including physical therapists, when they approach in an emergency and post-emergency situation.
Thank you. So what you say is rather to the answering the needs go beyond the traditional mobility restoration only, and look at the wider picture. And maybe one of you would like to say what has been for you in working continuously the biggest barrier in the working conditions which you face.
Then for us, I can talk about Haiti. We had a very long list of challenges during the terrible situation that we can resume in three main groups. The first main group is the restricted resources. So as that, we can mention the lack of professionals, lack of equipment, and surely the lack of finances. As a second group, we can mention the coordination services. Because as the team for rehabilitation is very a small team, but we don't have any structure. We didn't have any structure before. So that means we didn't have protocols, we didn't have anything. And as the third main group has challenges, we can mention the knowledges. No disaster preparedness of our professionals. Even most of us are very young physical therapists, newly trained. So that was primarily our first challenges to approach the physical therapy care during the disaster situation.
David, is it okay if I add some context to our experience in Haiti? So as you can tell, David and I were colleagues together in Haiti. I was in Canada on the 12 janvier 2010, whereas David was in country and working at a facility that had an 80-bed capacity and 800 patients the day after the earthquake as people left Port-au-Prince and traveled to his hospital. David was the only local physical therapist on site. Luckily, he was complemented by two American therapists who were present as part of a training program as teachers. And of his staff of three rehabilitation technicians, two had started the day before the earthquake. So if you can think of, it was definitely better than what would have happened the year before, where there would have been nothing, as David was only 6 months on the job after a long-fought process to lobby for his post at our facility, and to lobby for the hiring of the rehab technicians. It took a long time to build that small structure that faced this tidal wave of need at that time.
Yeah, thank you. So anybody wants to share experiences touching on the reality of the working conditions or questions on some of the points? Yes, Michael.
Thank you very much. Good morning, my name is Michael Steinbeck. I'm a physiotherapist. I'm working for CBM, which is an international development organization working in low-income countries. And my part is rehabilitation of people with disabilities. I want to refer to the situation in Haiti also, immediately post-earthquake. That was a situation where there has been a large influx of medical teams, mainly surgeons. And I think it has been very successful in terms of saving lives. But it has been quite a disaster, I think, or it has been a missed opportunity to develop sustainable programs. Like Shaun said, disasters are, in a way, an opportunity to develop sustainable programs, but it's not always the best situation. But I think here something went wrong, and maybe there's something for Nancy also to kind of help out in the future. What we saw, for example, in a hospital where I was partly involved is about 200 surgeons and doctors passed through that hospital in 1 week. I think they may have come with a few theater nurses. And in the 3 weeks that I was there, I saw two physiotherapists dealing with hundreds and hundreds of post-surgical cases, mainly in tents in the parking place. So you wonder, in daily life we work in multidisciplinary teams, and as soon as there's a disaster, people step on the plane on their own. And like I said, it has been successful in saving lives, but in rehabilitation, it was another disaster. And I think you can develop sustainable programs in a much more effective way if straight from the beginning you have this multidisciplinary part. Obviously, in earthquakes, every patient that ends up on the operating table needs physiotherapy, yeah, with all the fractures and so on. I mean, apart from the psychologists and so on, that is very much needed also, but rehab is needed. So I also raised this issue with the AAOS, which I think is the Academy or the Association, the American Association of Orthopedic Surgeons, that played a key role in sending out medical teams, and again, mainly surgeons. Wonderful job done on the surgical side. And they were still discussing this, and I believe somewhere this month they have a meeting about future planning of such intervention. So my point is that I think there's need for a discussion in a multidisciplinary way on the organizational level. I think the WCPT or maybe HVO should put this on their agenda for future situations, that we send out teams in instead of single discipline professionals. I think it's highly needed. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Yes, I mean the academy very proudly talks about sending, I think, 500 orthopedic surgeons in the immediate aftermath of the earthquake. And for many of those orthopedic surgeons, it was an extremely negative experience. They were totally unprepared for what they were getting into. Personally, they were stunned, shocked by what they saw. They didn't have some of these personal attributes that I was talking about. But there was never any thought on the part of, you know, the AAOS or the individuals who, many of whom just went on their own. They didn't even contact the AAOS. They just bought a plane ticket and went. I don't think there was any sort of larger perspective of a multidisciplinary team and the fact that the surgical act is actually just one part of the continuum of care that's needed. So yes, I agree completely. We were talking about this last night. I think one of the things that we saw in Haiti, and something I think will continue, is that with the new social media and the ability of people to communicate actually almost in real time during these emergencies, people who have funds, orthopedic surgeons, for example, will buy a plane ticket and will go. And they will not necessarily be going with an organization or as part of any organized response. They're going on their own and looking for a place that they can fit in. And I'm afraid that that's going to continue to be something that happens more and more as emergencies crop up, because I think there are people who have the resources and can do it, and they have the access to information through Facebook and Twitter and all that, and they feel that they can make a contribution. And yes, there were lives saved, but it could have been much more organized and perhaps have led to something more sustainable than it was.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Thomas from Handicap International, Thomas Calvo. I'm a colleague of Chiara. I've been coordinating the initial response of Handicap International in Haiti, but also in Indonesia during the tsunami. So I would like to add two or three points that seems to me quite important in when it comes to disaster management. First of all, yes, the continuity of care is a very important point. And I think before the disaster happened, it would be really important that physiotherapy, but also, overall rehabilitation team, so including occupational therapists as well, probably psych and surgeons, medical team, discussed together to better organize this comprehensive and coordinated response. Because I see that, first of all, there is a lot of disorganization, of course, during a disaster, and people tend not to communicate enough. Second point, transmission of information. When you are dealing with a patient as a surgeon or as a medical team, you have, on a compulsory fashion, to let a minimum amount of information for the team that will come after, given that you may not be linked directly with them. What did you proceed? What was the procedure you did on the patient? What is the recommendation for follow-up and so on? So, because the experience in Haiti and the tsunami, you are facing a person either at hospital or community level, and you don't know what is the history of the person. So medical team tend to keep the record for them because they think the patient won't keep the record and won't transmit the information. But believe me, the person that had the information with them, even a simple sheet of paper where the main recommendation and information was written, they keep it very preciously and they give it. So I would go probably for a very standard and simple information sheet that to be kept with every person that undertake a surgical or medical procedure. And the third point that seems to me very important, the cares doesn't stop after 3 or 4 weeks. So people tend to be discharged very quickly from the hospitals straight in the community. So for example, you would have someone coming for multiple fracture. he has multiple fractures precisely because his house fell down on him. So he gave the address of the house, but he won't come back to the house. Don't believe it. Don't expect him to come back to the house. So as a physical therapist myself at this time, the team were facing a huge, a very hard time to track down people in the community, in the city or in the rural area. It's extremely difficult. So what is important that you give a kind of appointment to the people when they go outside the hospital. So you give them information where they can reach you out when they are discharged from the hospital, so they can have a care follow-up afterwards. Because people are discharged in a matter of 3, 4, 5 days, 1 week if it's a very complicated case, because hospitals are overcrowded. They cannot keep the patient, and patients get lost. Okay, so and it's nearly impossible to have an outreach or mobile clinic to try to reach these people afterwards. So you have to kind of reverse the system. You have to give them an appointment. Maybe Shaun can explain a bit about what they did for Hospital des Chapelles in Haiti. But we set up focal points in the community and give the information to the patient jointly with CBM to kind of give them a rendezvous afterwards. You can come to see us, you can have a continuity of care, we can provide you with assistive device, with splints, because it's months and months and months for some of them. And the big challenge is also to deal with a new environment. It's not only about physical capacity, but about abilities to cope with a new situation, family situation, house, new house, maybe a displaced camp. So as a physical therapist, of course, you focus mainly on deficiencies and function, but keep in mind that it's also very much about the rest of the life of a person.
Thank you. Any comments from the panel? Yeah, David?
I will comment about hospital arbitrage from the beginning. So what we have as a system is to join the surgical team and internal medicine team doing one with them. That works very well. Then we can go with them, discuss about cases where the physical therapy is needed, and we explain what we do and give our expectations with the patient in the hospital. It's our department. We have two kind of patients: the patient who are in the hospital, the inpatient, and also we have a outpatient clinic. Since the patient is discharged from the hospital, we right away give an appointment to have a follow-up with the patient as an outpatient. So then they, during the disaster, we first work with the patient in the hospital and then open the out clinic for the one who will come as outpatient.
Yes, please.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to share 4 years experience in the earthquake area with everybody. My name is Hui Ming Chai. I came from Taiwan, and we have a big earthquake in 1999, which results in about 2,700 people died in that earthquake. And in the very beginning, I went there to help them to it's a horrible experience. And when there, lots of people die. So you just can do nothing. No electricity, no water, and nothing over there. The only thing you have is your brain. and your hands-on skills. So in the very beginning, what we did is try to help people to recover from the post-operative care. But later, I found that we can do lots of things, more than we can think. The most important thing is that people needed to remove lots of rocks from the digestive area. So they got an ankle sprain, they got a low back pain, and lots of things. So I think I'd like to share another experience. We're not just working in the post-operative care. The most important for us is to do some orthopedic physical therapy stuff to manage the soft tissue injuries. And that is quite important because they give the people over there the hope. You know, if you got back pain, you know, you lose your family, then you know, you feel very uncomfortable. But if they can decrease the pain, then they feel something better, then that would help their psychological recovery. So that's quite important for us. I really feel proud of about that experiences, because I know the value of the physical therapy over there. And the other thing I'd like to share with everybody is that about 1 year later, people got stress. We call the post-stress syndrome, post-traumatic stress syndrome. So lots of people got stroke. The rate for the stroke increased. So physical therapy needed to go over there to help them to get recovered. And same thing. At that moment, although we have electricity, we have water, but lots of road is not recovered. So we provide mobile physical therapy over there, but we needed to drive, and most of the time we needed to walk, and sometimes we use the helicopter, right, to go over there. So that's quite important, but I think the most thing is that how to recruit the people to there, because of course it is a dangerous area. People, most of the physical therapy in Taiwan like to go, but they are afraid of the situation over there, and their family would be the most barrier to ask them not to go. So how to persuade physical therapists to go there is another issue. I don't know how to do that, but just try to recruit and to persuade them to do that. Otherwise, you got no manpower and you got nothing. Yeah, I really sorry. I just. When I say talking about that, I feel so, you know, the whole image comes back immediately. So that's why I feel so, I'm sorry about that. But
thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing sharing this with us. And this underlines a bit the reality of the working conditions in the ground, even in a country like Taiwan. And preparedness is the key to everything. Multidisciplinary approach also, and to try to reduce the complications, unnecessary complications. It comes all back in your story. Which thank you for this. Is there anybody else who wants to share? Yes, please.
I have a question for the team. Maybe Nancy can answer this best, but any of your perspectives, just thinking about how you all talked about the disjointed response and how that has continued, especially in terms of surgeons and other people just being lone rangers and going there. Do you think it would be possible to, ahead of time, organize groups of volunteers who would be willing to go quickly as a team and to, you know, have surgeons sign up and say, in the event of a disaster, because they're going to find out about it so quickly anyway, I'm willing to go right away, and maybe have them decide on countries they'd be willing to go to. But I wonder if that would, if you think that would even work as something that might be feasible.
Well, there's been a lot of discussion about that, as you might imagine. A lot of the associations that HVO works with have appointed task forces and groups to look at how they could improve the whole process and the whole response to disasters. I'm going to share with you my own personal opinion, which is a little cynical. I think you can do that. I think you can set it up. You can get people to sign up. You can try and develop this very coordinated response. My own personal thought is it'll break down as soon as the emergency happens. And that may be just way too cynical. I think it's worth trying. I know USAID tried something with the Haiti experience where they tried to get people to register on a website with their, you know, tell us what your skills and expertise are, and then NGOs could go and look through and identify people. We collaborated with HIUS, and we actually screened prospective PT volunteers to help relieve HI of the burden of actually hiring additional staff to go out, you know, to do the screening. So there are attempts by organizations to collaborate that way. But I just think there is this, I think I like your use of the word Lone Ranger. I mean, there is a lot of that, and every disaster, I keep thinking we can educate the public to better understand what is really needed and how they can really contribute. And every disaster, I'm once again reminded that despite all the attempts, we seem to be still at the same place.
If I may add a few comments on that. Yeah, the recruitment process is really crucial moment. It takes a lot of energy, a lot of time, a lot of resources, and we always struggle to find people available to live, I mean, with appropriate profile. University, for example, were mobilized in North America for the IT response. But there are so many factors influencing the choice of appropriate physical therapists that are willing to leave, that really requires a great screening process, the setting of some criteria, like experience, not only the clinical experience, but also some personal features, ability to cope, ability to adapt. And it is not always possible to test them. So ideally, for example, HI would like to do some pretest to be able to assess these aspects that are very, very important. Working in a very, very demanding context, over pressure for working 20 hours per day. But it is not always feasible. So the whole concept of preparedness seems to be really important. And I think that, for example, WCPT would play a role in this, in putting together resources and being responsive to this kind of events in advance, so to be ready to do that. On the multidisciplinary approach, yeah, it was proposed to send a team of multidisciplinary team. Yeah, that's very complex as well, because we need to channel really the human resources in the existing international organization system that very quickly is set up. And nowadays, for example, the existence of cluster on health, there are groups that coordinates several organizations working on health issues. in the disaster site seems to be the latest way to cope with this complex context. The single organizations cannot send their multidisciplinary team like this. It is really necessary to have a broad vision and be able to coordinate.
Hi, I'm Kim Dunleavy. I'm also have been part of Health Volunteers for quite some time. My question is sort of twofold, same sort of question, but from two perspectives, and that's the coordination, but from the NGO side and the assistance side, on the one hand, where you might have duplication of services and whether anybody can comment on that. And then from the opposite side, from the recipient side and from the PTs who are working in the disaster areas, how sometimes that coordination aspect, if they're expected to contribute to the coordination, takes away from their ability to do the services in the first place. And I think there are a number of people besides the panelists who obviously have experience in the room, so maybe it's not just for the panelists as well.
Thank you.
Thank you for those questions, Kim. They bring forward a lot of issues that I think will create for very constructive dialogue. But I should mention as well that disasters are different, so the contexts of them need to be factored into that. The one with it in which I have experience was one with a tremendous international response, so there was substantial duplication. I know that's not representative of all disasters. And I did happen to be in Haiti over the course of four hurricanes that had a death toll of over 5,000 people and didn't get the same response. So as far as the duplication of services goes, that was part of my reality of being involved in the coordination of the rehabilitation response in Haiti. And it was a frustrating experience to see resources and efforts focused in specific areas. And I happened to work at a facility that started a prosthetic clinic that was doing great work, but in a country where there had been very little prosthetic work, and it had been estimated by people involved with ISPO that about 9 facilities would be about right for Haiti. During our cluster meetings in April, 3 months after the disaster, there were 21 parties planning to open one because the international mindset was on the amputees in Haiti. And since leaving the country, I've talked to other colleagues about this, and the comment of one with substantial experience from the tsunami and experiencing similar things was that it's understandable for organizations to message, brand, and market themselves like Nike shoes, because there is competition in the small donation market. We can accept that that's the reality of the world right now, but I also think that we are in a position as a profession that has the opportunity to influence this slightly. And hopefully, if we can't direct the fact that resources will be thrown at things that capture people's attention, that at least we can then direct that they're used more equitably afterwards. So the prime part of your question for duplication is yes, there is. For coordination, is there anyone who has an opinion on coordination? Okay, I have one on those too. And the answer to that too is yes. My role in Haiti post-earthquake was primarily coordination, and I didn't really see patients again until November. I think that those efforts were well spent. So what I can say, I've spoken with many people who found that their clinical services were not used to their full capacity because the setting didn't allow them to use it, that people were concentrated in some areas where other areas were not necessarily served. And I hope that the coordination work that some of us in the room were involved with helps at least alleviate and spread that out a little bit. So it does detract from clinical services, but I do see a very important value to that.
Is there anybody from who wants to share some experiences in this matter, duplication of services, coordination, the role of the national authorities, regulatory role, also planning role, or the lack thereof, or the incapacity to get it. Anybody wants to share? Yeah, okay, let's finish this topic and then we go to the next one.
Just a few comments on that to add on what Shaun just said. There is a kind of compulsory coordination system during disaster of fair size, say. This is UN, United Nations, role to coordinate on different issues, like Chiara said, like, for example, health, water and sanitation, provision of shelter, provision of, whatever the sector is. You have a UN agency that is supposed to coordinate jointly also with a representative of the ministry. So for Haiti, for example, we had health cluster or health thematic coordination, where every organization involved in this issue would be invited and there would be a lead guidance given by WHO and the Ministry of Health. It worked quite fairly after a while in Haiti, I would say, not at the beginning. Shaun, please don't laugh. When under this coordination, you would have sub-cluster or working group on very important thematic. So in Haiti, we had, what was the name again? Injury, Rehabilitation, Disability Working Group that was led by, at the time, it was Handicap International, Christian Blind Mission, and the Secretary of State for Integration of People with Disability, which is a government entity. And there was a very active participation of Hospital Albert Schweizer. And I think it was of course, a bit difficult, very difficult at the beginning, because there were many organizations involved. But we did, at the time, step by step, really improve, I think, the delivery of services, geographically speaking, meaning trying to fill the gap in the geographical coverage, but also in terms of type of services that will be delivered. And particularly, there were very strong recommendations about appropriate and non-appropriate behavior for organization in terms of providing physiotherapy services or more specially prosthetic and orthotic services, like taking patients outside of the country just to fit them with a prosthesis without any caretaker or member of the family and sending them back in Haiti, or the same for people having sustained a spinal cord injury. We are taking now, again, people that were evacuated overseas. They are coming back to Haiti right now, 1.5 years after people with spinal cord injury that have undertaken surgery. But what do you think? These people are coming back to Haiti right now. They have been, supported in terms of care, but in another country, and now they have to get back to Haiti. And the true challenge is really right now. It's for them to do their rehab now in Haiti, in Port-au-Prince, in a city that is completely still destroyed in many areas. So this is not an appropriate, conduct for professional. You have to do the physical rehabilitation on site where the person will have to live the rest of his life. So just to, I think as a group, I mean, organization that were really involved in this sub-coordination, we did a fair job, but you don't have to, as an organization coming to a country like this after a disaster, you are not obliged to coordinate in such areas. So some of them really were willing to coordinate, other organizations just did their thing on their own without coordinating anything. So that's still a big challenge.
One thing we haven't really addressed, but I think is an issue in the coordination of services and duplication of services, is the role of the donor. And, I run an NGO. I'm always looking for money, as all of us are. And in these situations, a lot of what drives NGOs and drives decisions and drives the development of programs is where the donor dollars are. And I think your example of 21 P&O centers is a perfect example. Some donors decided this was a priority. doesn't matter what the needs are, it doesn't matter what the data show, this is what the donors want. And that's always something that's underlying the work that is done in the field that I think we sometimes forget, but it's a huge driver of decisions.
David, you want to say something?
Yes. It's just a comment about the aspect that you mentioned, Thomas mentioned, about coming back with the spinal cord injury patient. It's really true. It's true that it's not the same situation. Even in the same country, in Haiti, the situation in Port-au-Prince and where the patient will continue living is not the same. So what we strongly suggest to the organization is to do the home assessment and trying to get the injured patient living and try adapt the situation with its own situation. Adapt the environment with his own situation. That's what we strongly suggest with the organization.
Okay, I think we will leave this here, but there is obviously an issue between decisions which are indeed donor-driven or donor-influenced, and the possibility of the local authorities and the strength and the organization of the local authorities and to channel the support in the best possible way. Yes, please.
Yep. I'm Zach from the United States. I have a comment about coordination of education in different countries after disaster relief. I went into Iraq in about 2003 after the war had started. And by that time, after the first Gulf War, there were a lot of organizations already working there, like HI was already there, Emergency, an organization called ACORN, and a few others. And I'm not mentioning them for, trying to criticize or anything like that. But one of the problems I noticed in Iraq is that all these different organizations had their own training programs. And then the government had a training program. And then also local doctors picked up on the idea of having a physical therapist, and they just kind of had on-the-job training. And there's physical therapists there all the way from just having like on-the-job training to maybe a 1 or 2 year program with a particular organization, and then all the way to a kind of a bachelor's degree in Baghdad. And I was just wondering if anybody's had any experience or wants to comment on trying to do a better job in the future of coordinating education in the future so that you kind of alleviate this problem of having people being called physiotherapists for having on-the-job training all the way to a bachelor's level education. Because right now Iraq is in a problem where they're trying to, define physical therapy and come up with a licensure and a long-term plan for physical therapy in the country. And they're trying to figure out what to do with these, on-the-job trained physios all the way up to bachelor's degree educated PTs.
There you open a crucial issue of human resources training. Is there somebody from Iraq happens to be around here who would like to comment? Okay, somebody from the panel? Yeah?
Yeah, you really mentioned a critical aspect. I will give you another example, Afghanistan, where the needs are huge, where there is a chronic need of physical therapists, where the demand of physical therapy is increasing due to the war, conflict, poverty, lack of services. But at the same time, and I think it is a good lesson that we can learn from this country, at the same time, there are many organizations, international organizations, local NGOs, there is the local school. Here we have representatives of the School of Physiotherapy. That are nowadays working together to try to build something sustainable and consistent according to international standards. And it is, in my opinion, it is a long way, it is a hard way, but it is the right way to do it. So you have international organization, HI, like ICRC, like the Swedish committee, like, but I could make a long list. There are the Afghan physiotherapists with the school, there is the Afghan National Association of Physical Therapists. They are trying really to coordinate their efforts to increase, raise the standards. In Afghanistan, there is the issue of the issue, is a reality. PTAs, so physiotherapy assistants, were trained by different organizations in the different corners of the country, where you have to remember that there are also security issues, so very isolated areas of the country, where, for example, physiotherapists cannot go to do a training in Kabul because for them it would be very dangerous to travel to the capital, for example. Then I will leave the word to Najmuddin.
Yeah, there are a few people from Afghanistan also in the audience, so maybe you want to add something about the situation, the training situation for physiotherapists or in Afghanistan?
Well, first I would like to mention some few points about the coordination. I have few experience about the coordination, if there are no coordination. In the past, many years ago, I remember an organization, they brought pre-made prosthesis to Afghanistan that was not possible to fit. Everybody knows that it cannot be fit to the amputees. It needs custom-made prosthesis. And also it affects directly the standard. If everybody comes and does their own way, and then you cannot keep the standard. And if there is no coordination, body should be mostly through the health system of the local health system. And about the education, about the training of the physiotherapist, I have experienced, we have a local school in Afghanistan. It was started by an organization called IAM. Now it is on the hand of Afghans, and they run this school, and it is sustainable, and it will remain forever. And what we can collaborate to have a certain standard and a high standard, we can have our centers, our rehabilitation centers, for clinical placement of the student, those they come for clinical placement from the school. At the same time, we have trained physiotherapists that they can teach at the school, and this is a collaboration that can increase the quality of the education.
To return to your original question, Zach, I do have some experience with coordination of training, and I will hazard a guess that the actors that initiated these different training programs, if they were interested in coordination, may have faced a debate as to whether they wished to talk about this and come to a consensus with other actors and colleagues, or if the need was so great that there was a need for immediate training and action. And I think that is a debate that many people come across, especially with my experience of the coordination being slow. And I'll at least give the training programs the benefit of the doubt of having done what they thought was the right thing at that time. But I hope that there's now more of an initiative to coalesce these different efforts into something that's more streamlined. On the whole, I would generally encourage people to devote the time into doing some coordination so that there can be standardization. But if there is an immediate need, I can respect that as long as there's a longer-term vision to bring things together and make it more consistent.
Yeah, and of course, any training of significance which goes beyond 1 month or 2 months, it should, a few months longer, it should be aimed at having a governmental recognition, because otherwise you train, you invest a lot in people who have no career possibilities, who will not stay. So it is the building national capacities means not only coordinating among organizations, but B, do it together with the authorities. One remark of David, and then the gentleman.
And also I can add as an aspect the how that is really dangerous for the national capacity building. For example, with those people who are training, working, to fit them in the national association, it would be a little difficult after.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the panel regarding this very good discussion. My name is Aziz Ahmad. I'm leading the physiotherapy training institute in Afghanistan. And there is only one training institute of physiotherapy in Afghanistan, which is a government running institute. As we discussed regarding the training and shortage of physiotherapy in Haiti and also in Afghanistan, so I just want to share some of my experience, and maybe at the end would like from the panel to share their idea if they have some idea about this. So it's really the demand is one thing and the standard is another thing. As a physiotherapist, we are all keeping our standards as high as possible. In Afghanistan, the needs are high for physiotherapy. There is a shortage of physiotherapy. We are around 30 million people, and we have 300 physiotherapists. But when there is a talking about the number of physiotherapy, so the organizations originally, when they are separated in different parts of Afghanistan, so they come together and say that, oh, we have a rehabilitation center in this part of Afghanistan, and we need physiotherapy. How to do? There is no physiotherapy. And then they come to the government, Ministry of Health, and say, okay, go to the physiotherapy institute, conduct a two-month course for people, and then they are physiotherapists. And then we say, no, this is not physiotherapist. What is 2 months? And they said, okay, so we will make a deal and then make it 6 months. And then also the physiotherapists in Afghanistan, they would like to keep their standards high. They said, no, 6 months is not enough for physiotherapy training. What a person can do. And then they say, okay, so finally we come with a 1 year, so go. And then physiotherapist says, and the physiotherapy association are resisting in this and say, no, this is not enough for physiotherapists. If you want to keep the standards, if you really want to do something for the patients to support them, so let's keep the standards high. Otherwise, if you want to kill the patients, so for this is not physiotherapist. So it's a somehow that two watermelon cannot be in one hand. So you will keep the standards or you will keep the demands. So this is really a challenging environment. But the organizations come together and then they discuss that how to cope with this situation. So we should keep the standards high, and also we should do somehow to facilitate faster training or faster training of physiotherapy in this country. So there is only one institution, governmental based, so they just try to support the capacity of this institution to reach to the regions. For example, from Kabul, they can have a satellite program in the north of the country, in the south of the country, in the east of the country. They can send teachers there, and then they teach physiotherapists from the base level there. This will fasten the program. And also, every year, the capacity of this school is to only hire 20 students. So let's increase the capacity to 30 students, to 35 students. So this will keep, from one hand, keep the standards high. From the another hand, the number of physiotherapy gets increased, and the people can get a good physiotherapy, not just do something in the name of physiotherapy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. This also shows even if there is a national authority and a national school, there are still challenges in context of conflict and disasters. Yes, Beto.
My name is Alberto Cairo, Italian. I've been working in Afghanistan for quite many years, so I have a certain knowledge of the situation. I'm very sorry to hear that countries like Haiti and Afghanistan are experiencing completely different situation. Afghanistan seems to go better, at least from the physiotherapy point of view. Haiti seem to be struggling and not to have a future. Well, I'm quite convinced looking, I mean, as I don't know much about Haiti, only things I read and what I have heard now. But I heard also you were saying something about donors. The donors, they come, they go, they tell you do this, do that, do that. Well, I think that if there is a winning point in Afghanistan, if there is, the donors. The donors have been there, the same donors, for a very long time. Looking around at the organization, working in Afghanistan in the field of rehabilitation, we can name five of them, Handicap International, Swedish Committee, the Red Cross, IEM, and they have been there for 25 years, 30 years. They are committed, and they all together coordinate things, and through the school, and talking and working with the government, and now passing the responsibility, transferring the responsibility to the government. I mean, this is the big, those who are guilty in the disaster of Haiti are the donors. I mean, everybody knows that if you want to build something in the physical rehabilitation field, you must be there for a long time. It is something that starts in emergency and goes beyond emergency. It goes definitely into development. So I'm not an analyst, but from my experience, I can say that if in Afghanistan it works, it's because of the donors. They're there, they've been there for a long time, and they want to be there. While in Haiti, it's not the point. That's what I wanted to say.
I'd just like to clarify that when I refer to donors, I'm not referring to organizations like HI and ICRC. I'm referring to family foundations or individuals, and in my case, I'm thinking of the U.S., but individuals who have significant resources and are, you know, they go to HI and they say, I'll give you $500,000 to build a P&O clinic. And then the question, the ethical question for HI is, will they accept that and do that if they are feel that it probably isn't needed? And, you know, these are questions that NGOs deal with all the time. But I think that I'm not saying that organizations that are on the ground delivering services are the donors. I'm making the distinction there. Just want to make sure that's clear.
Yeah, thank you for this clarification. So we are approaching 10 o'clock. We have maybe time for one or two questions. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Venkat. I'm coming from another chronically affected country, that's Cambodia. I mean, working in Cambodia, I work for the Red Cross. I would like to compare the emergency situations with young girls. Everybody is attracted, a lot of opportunities, a lot of funds pouring in, but the real life starts after the honeymoon. So in the initial situation, in the acute phase, the brutal truth is the international organizations compete for their share, compete for their place. They all want to do good, but there is a competition, and sometimes there is repetitions of programs even. But in long term, the sustainability has to be built upon the local resources. We are not committed there forever. So when you go there, this is my request to any international organization, when you go there in the emergency situation, of course it is a good opportunity, but the initial MOUs should make the local government get committed to these programs. So in long term, nobody is going to be there forever. And unless the local government, the national government is committed to these programs, either it is a small physical rehabilitation center or a national, a sectoral or national level activity, it's going to collapse. And there are so many examples for that already. So in some countries, of course, they are low income countries, but still there is budget, and the priority is not going to the rehabilitation sector. So Ministry of Health could be a little bit better than Ministry of Social Affairs. But even if 0.2% of the budget spent on defense could be spent on rehabilitation, that should be enough to cover the programs that were initiated by the international organizations. So you should get involved and get the governments to commit to those, to the sustainability of services, apart from building the capacity at national levels.
Thank you. Thank you. Very important point. Yes, the gentleman at number four.
My name is Fritz Hunzel. I'm an American now, but was born and lived a major part of my life in a developing country, Suriname. I was the first trained physical therapist of Suriname, trained here in Holland 51 years ago. Went back and had the same experience as a tsunami or a disaster, because the physicians were ruling medical care. There was a rehab in the form of a rehab physician, but there was no structure. And a question that I have for the panel, maybe someone can give a response to that, is looking at centralization of a structured template for someone as a physical therapist working in a country where a disaster happened, that they can grab through and say, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are the pointers. Those are the things that I have to be concerned about. So that if they get questions about what presence or assistance they need, that they can take certain steps. I'm not sure how far the Red Cross and WCPT are tied in having something like this in place. The reason I bring it up, working in Suriname, the queen of this country, then a princess, got married, and she had a big presence that she wanted to give to Suriname. And that had to be a rehab center. And all of a sudden, the physicians were sitting on the table, and the people from the Department of Health and Social Affairs, and they were talking about their rehab center while I was there as a loner doing my job. It was a group of ladies who stood up because their kids were involved in physical therapy training. They went to the department. They said, wait a minute, have Fritz sit at the table as well. And that's the way that I got involved in helping structuring the rehab center. So my question is, if we're looking at international services, yes, everybody wants to use their money the way they like. And that's great. In Raleigh, where I live now, I got a group of physicians approach me. They said, oh, you're involved in volunteering. We want to build a clinic, a medical clinic in Haiti. I give them the indications of the United Nations, the UNESCO, and that in the Dominican Republic, there are already initiatives taken with the money that was available. So if they would hook up with them, because HVO that I worked for as well won't get involved in the acute phase of this disaster probably, but is in the position that they can follow up in what you're talking about, the educational part of it. And the sustainability of projects, once something started up, can have a good follow-up. Because in Suriname, they work in their follow-up after the rehab center was built. Instead of having physical therapists coming to the Netherlands to get trained, they started the program of physical therapy at their medical school, because the need was clear then. And the assistant that came about to help out, that was donated via the volunteers from HEO.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm looking forward to look to the situation in Suriname, which seems to be one step further than the two countries which we have been mainly discussing here. To answer very shortly your question, because it's 10 o'clock, a template for how to approach physical therapy, physical rehabilitation. There are many, many reference guidelines. There are many general reference guidelines. They exist. I was not aware before before this panel, but I went on the WCPT website, and they did a very good job in disaster management. There are a whole lot of sub-documents, and within these documents, you have a lot of other guidelines as well on all kinds of things. I know that organizations like Handicap International, HVO, the ICRC also, we have our own guidelines for people who are coming with us, how to set up centers, what is the approach. Yes? Uh, 30 years ago, not, but nowadays I see them with a computer. But your point is taken. There is need for dissemination of guidelines. If there are no major points, I just want to wrap up. Yes.
Thank you, everybody, for the panel discussion today. I think that, you know, up until this point, as far as I know, there has not been a group like this in the same room with NGOs, with all the people with the experience. And I think that having that experience from so many different organizations, if we're able to put that together so that it is available and more in the press or in the literature, that it will actually be easier to gain the information that Fritz is talking about in the future. So I think the lessons learned from the past is something that maybe we could do a better job at it, putting out. Thank you.
Right. So this is one of the recommendations out of this panel. Another one, I think, is the highlight of the media and the money availability versus the long-term follow-up in the same context versus the follow-up of other people with disabilities who are not directly affected by the disaster. That there is something which it's an ethical question which has to be taken into account, but as well there are many countries which face the exactly the same problems like Haiti before 2008, that the needs of people with disabilities were completely underaddressed. So we should not forget, let's not be focused on disasters only. It is very important to be aware that there are many large needs which are underaddressed. Good intentions are required, but and absolutely necessary, but they are not enough. We need to have a professional approach, and we need to have professionals. this is very important, otherwise we will do more harm than good. And for sustainability, of course, it is very important to focus on the government, to collaborate with local organizations and local authorities, and not in an isolated manner. And last but not least, the preventive role, the essential role of physiotherapists to in early disasters has become much more visible during the last years, and I hope that this will lead to something on a more structural matter. So I thank the panel, I thank you for your availability, and